As you know, there is a basic difference between animals and human beings. There are many ways they are different. Many thinkers have said that man is a creature who can use language, who can stand erect and use his fingers, flexibility of fingers. That has given man an added advantage over animals. Human beings have language, therefore they can preserve, they can codify their thoughts and ideas for the posterity. Animals don't have. There is a great thinker, the Nobel laureate Bergson, who says that man is different from animals because animals fight with natural tools, their teeth, their claws. But human beings have the capability or the capacity to use artificial tools. Because to make an artificial tool needs a lot of intelligence, which animals do lack. So when an animal will attack, it will attack with its natural tools, with teeth, with claws, with all that. But the human beings can create weapons, tools by which they can attack. That is why when human beings attack, they become more harmful than animals. Because animals are harmful, they are harmful in their innocent ways. The animal will attack from the front, man can attack from behind. This is another way they distinguish between men and animals. Animals cannot take tools, they manage with the natural tools, but as human beings are capacitated, you are empowered, more empowered because they have artificial tools. There are others who say that man is a creature who can give reasons. Animals cannot. This is a very significant way. That takes us to action. Now, see that man is not the only living being. There are many other living beings, animals, birds, reptiles, microorganisms. They are also living. Trees also live. They are born, they grow and they die in a very extended sense. And some thinkers go to say that even an atom also there is life. Oh, hidden life, vibrant in every atom. Animation. Oh, hidden life, vibrant in every... We don't see it, perceive it, because it is so dormant. It is so latent, so dormant. So very concealed or so very potential for... It appears as if it is non-living. There is nothing like non-living. Even an atom has the capacity in growth of evolution. It also will grow through different stages of evolution. Grows into a plant, then an animal, then a human being, then goes on. So the whole universe is, you know, scientists say that there is energy, there is nothing like matter, there is only flow of energy. Now the scientists say that energy, that is not only energy, but energy is obeying a direction. Whether it's a sun, solar system, the different planets orbiting around the solar system, the respective orbits, the very high velocity. Or in an atom where electrons spin around the nucleus, there is activity everywhere. If you bombard a nucleus of an atom, it releases tremendous energy. So there is a flow of energy, but again they say, it is not that there is energy, but the energy is obeying a direction. Therefore, you have to admit consciousness as a principle which directs and which is responsible for the way, which explains the way energy behaves. Because, Einstein says, Newton says that nature never plays dice. Is never capricious. You can predict 100 years in advance the mutual position of Earth, Moon and Sun. Therefore, you can predict the solar eclipse and lunar eclipse 1000 years ahead, because we know pretty well that nature will never behave whimsically. And animal also never behaves whimsically. If you give a bread to a dog, you know how it is going to respond. If you pat on your pet, then you know that you will know that the hairs will stand on his end. It will feel like coming near you. It will wag its tail. You know that if you stand before a dog with a loaf of bread in hand, another stick in hand, the dog will look at the bread and but it will run away for the fear of being bitten. So the animal behavior is predictable. The hunter knows how the tiger is going to behave. That is why it can catch it. Because tiger's behavior can be predicted, can be mapped in advance. You know a priori, you know beforehand how the tiger is going to behave, how the elephant is going to behave. You ask the hunters, they will tell you about the fixed ways, determinate ways by which the animals and birds behave. That is how the hunter catch, they put nets and put birds and catch birds and the hunters. Because they know that if this is the stimulus, what is going to be the response? So the response of this reaction of an animal is predictable. Why? because they don't have freedom. An animal doesn't have a freedom. You know, even though there are instincts in animals, for example, the motherly instinct is present even in animal world. The cow would scare you away if you go near the calf. The cat will run away with the kitten if it apprehends some danger. The birds, after giving birth to their siblings, they try to protect the birds by extending their wings. So the motherhood is present even in animal world. That motherly protective love for the children. But if an animal is, if you keep them hungry for 4 days, the cat will snatch away food from the kitten because their hunger instinct dominates. Even there are instances where the mother cat will eat the kitten to satiate the hunger. In other words, even though they share some human sentiments, when there is hunger, sleep, sex or fear, they don't discriminate. They are driven by instincts. Because they are driven by instincts, the behavior of an animal can be understood in relation to the antecedents. Why did the animal, you know, there was a platoon commander here, Monisher, about 25 years back. He had a dog, so well disciplined and so loyal a dog. One day he came from the office, as soon as I came there, he jumped upon him and tore him to pieces, that 120 battalion, the commander, the sergeant, chief. Why? He did not know that his servant has forgotten to give him food. So out of hunger, you know, he just pounced on him. That is an animal. But human beings do feel hungry, they do feel sleepy, they do have fear, but a human mother may prefer to die in favor of the child. We have seen while, you know, doing relief works in the, you know, flood stricken area, people are marooned people, they have not taken food for 3-4 days. But if you give a piece of bread or a bread, mother will say, no, my child will take fast. There is a beautiful sonnet by Donne, those who are from English, they will say, that in the war field, there are two warriors. Their throat is parched in hunger. They are going to die, thirst. They are going to die because of water. A cup of water, a glass of water comes. Then one soldier says, he says, you take. He says, no, you take. Thy necessity is greater than mine. It's a human person. Who used to write explanations of this. Thy necessity is greater than mine. A mother may prefer to die in favor of the child. Let me go to suffering, but this is a human possibility. So, the human mother has a choice, has a freedom to choose either to snatch away food from the child or to prefer to live or die starved and allow the child to live. So human beings have choices. There only, wherever there is a choice, freedom is meaning. Suppose you pass out from, you know, plus two, you pass out in your college, there is only one honors, English honors, who used to have in regional college. Do you have freedom? You don't have freedom to choose because you have the only honors available. So freedom means you have freedom to choose. You have freedom to choose means there are alternatives. So freedom, exercising freedom means you have alternatives and you choose. In English there is a, Robert Frost, there is a poem, The Road Not Taken, says that when I stood on my, at a particular juncture, the person stands, different ways are open, arts or science or commerce, let us say. And one momentous decision to go in a particular way, you know, later on you said, oh, the way I took, that has made all the difference. It has made all the difference. So freedom becomes meaningful only when there are alternatives. I am just going very fast so that I will be addressing the topic in details. So, whenever you talk of action, you see, you can't say that animal acts. In circus, for example, the elephant makes puja, the tigers also show some gymnastics. Can you say that they act? It's a conditioned behavior. When the parrot ही सेज मे गॉड ब्लेस यू भगवान मंगल करंतु वेलकम वेलकम स्वागतम इफ ए थीप कम्स आल्सो ही विल से स्वागतम इज कंडीशन व्हेन एनीबॉडी एंटर्स यू विल से ही कैन नॉट डिस्क्रिमिनेट व्हेदर ही कम्स विद अ बैड इंटेंशन और गुड इंटेंशन इट्स अ कंडीशन यू कैन नॉट से दैट द एलिफेंट इज प्रेइंग यू कैन नॉट से दैट द टाइगर इज बिहेविंग प्रेडिक्टेबली व्हाई Because there is a ringmaster holding a electric hunter. The tiger knows that if I don't behave properly, predictably, as per the wish of my master, ringmaster, then I am going to be slashed. I don't know how painful it is, the electric hunter. So the tiger has been conditioned to behave in a particular way when there is a particular signal. So you cannot say that the tiger behaves creatively. The tiger acts because the behavior of the tiger in a circus. Or the elephant in a circus, or a bear in a circus, is a conditioned behavior. The behavior of, you cannot say that parrot is praying, because the appropriate behavior, other behavior is lacking, and the animal behavior is always a reaction to a stimulus. There is a basic difference between a reaction and a response. Human beings respond, whereas animals react. This is a fundamental difference between the way human beings. Act or react to a situation and the animals. Suppose you throw grain on the floor and put a net. The hunter is waiting at a distance and will find that the birds descend without being able to realize why is it that at one point of time so much of grain is available. Is there any malafide intention on the part of a person who has put the grains? They cannot. They are hungry. There are good grains. They will descend and get caught. And hunter knows pretty well the behavior of the birds, how the birds will behave when I just litter the grains on the floor. So, in itself, animals, non-human beings, living beings, non-humans, they react. Given one stimulus, there is only one response. So when you give a stimulus, you can predict what kind of response will come. But in case of human beings, one stimulus, difficult to say how a human being will behave. Whether mother will snatch away the food from the child, allowing the child to die, or she will prefer to die, letting the child live. That means, given a stimulus, same human being may respond in different ways at different points of time, and different people will react differently at a given point of time. Suppose that without any provocation, I scold somebody or beat somebody without he has not done any harm to me. You know that you have not done any harm to me. I give you a big blow. Difficult to say how the person will be. It is quite possible that he kneels down and prays, "Oh God, I have not done anything. Why did this gentleman?" Became so very, he became so very angry and gave me a blow without no fault of mine. Oh God, forgive me. Another may say, okay, you have given me blows. You give me as many blows as you like. If you slap in one cheek, he sold the other cheek. The first one is a Christian. He has imbibed the ideals of Jesus. Jesus who stands, who is forgiveness incarnate. When he was being crucified on the cross, nailed on the cross, there was no slightest, impression of agony or annoyance or revenge or hatred or cause. Rather, he said he was praying on their behalf. He was praying, God, oh God, forgive them because they know not what they do. Forgiveness. There is no sin, no crime which cannot be forgiven. There is no error and no crime, no sin, no omission and commission. The magnitude can be so great that it cannot deserve your forgiveness. This is Jesus. One enactment on the part of Jesus made every third man a Christian in the world. One third of the population, they profess Christianity. Because of one enactment, Jesus continues to inspire us in his absence as well. As much as he would have done had he lived till today. The second one is Gandhian. why does he show the other cheek? Because he is convinced that the goodness is innate in the person, however abominable, sinful he may be. Oh, he has anger. If I go on showing the different cheek, the other cheek, then at one point of time he will realize the goodness will, within him will get aroused. He shows the other cheek not that he is weak. But Gandhi says, only violent man can be non-violent. Non-violence is not the weapon of the weak. Only a person who is capable of greatest violence can take non-violence, because it needs calls for a lot of courage, psychic metal to face a situation. So a person who shows the other cheek is a second response. Because because he loves the offender and he knows pretty well, he is sanguine that the goodness which lies latent or dormant in the person will get aroused. Paunsutalaraniya. He is making dread. For some reason, he is angry, he is annoyed, he is revengeful, or he is trying to avenge. But how long? So hatred has to be, the third man will give a counter slap. Third response. He says, why? I have not done anything. If I don't say anything, it will encourage him. So I become party to the mistake he is committing. I am encouraging him by remaining passive or silent. My passive tolerance of such an action, uncalled for action on the part of an offender, will encourage him. I don't want to be a coward. If I remain silent, it will be a sign of timidity. This is the third response. The fourth man will simply say, okay, it has happened. It will be part of my destiny. Maybe God wanted to say something, will teach me something, maybe I have some, he will try to do soul searching. You see, one stimulus, but four, five responses. But the person who shows the other cheek is also capable of giving a counter slap. And the person who gives a counter slap is also capable of behaving in the way a Christian behaves. Choices are open. So, that means, man is free to choose. Given 20 rupees or 100 rupees, difficult to say how a student, he may save the money, someone will save the money, someone will spend it along with friends, someone will try to spend it for his own selfish pleasure, somebody will donate it for a social cause. Difficult to say how the human beings respond. So response is one stimulus. So action is a one-many response system, but reaction is one stimulus, one response. But human beings, one stimulus, one situation, there are manifold responses. There lies human freedom. Suppose I tie somebody and throw it on a child and child dies. Who will attract the provisions of law? Not the person who has really killed, but a person who has tied him. Why? Because he didn't have freedom. Suppose to tie my hands and throw me on somebody and he is injured, I am not the agent. Because I have not freely acted. When you sleep, for example, when you sleep with your father or mother, and in dream you kick your father, we don't say that the child has become wayward, he has kicked his father, because he has not done it purposely, he has not done it with freedom. He has not done it consciously, purposely. That is why. If a child commits a crime, he is exonerated. If a madman commits a crime, he is exonerated, because they are not actions under freedom. So when you act under freedom, then only you are responsible for your action, the consequences. There is a Sartre, great existentialist, says that human beings have there is the prerogative of man to be free. And that is also brings a lot of things for man. Man is condemned to be free, because when you act with the freedom. Action and freedom must go together. But you see, once you act, and once you own the action, you have to own what follows the action, the consequences. If action is not yours, responsibility is not yours. If you ask somebody, why did you kill the boy? I was helpless, sir. I didn't have any. They came and pointed a bayonet, they tied me, and they threw me to the child. I didn't have freedom. I didn't choose to. Given a freedom, I would not have thought of even killing the child. So it is the work of the gangsters. So it is the gangsters who will attract the provisions of law because they have acted freely. They could have acted otherwise. That is why, friends, all rewards and punishments, all moral judgments become meaningful because we are free. A good action is rewarded because the person who has done good action, he was free not to do it, but he has preferred to do it, rewarded. A person who has committed a crime, he is punished because it was his freedom not to commit the crime. So the freedom is there, lies at the back of all rewards and punishment. Morality becomes meaningful because of freedom. Morality, if human beings were not free, then we could not say that human beings are moral agents. Moral agency goes hand in hand with freedom. If you can prove that you have not done it purposely or freely, you see, the court will exonerate you. If you can prove that you have not done it purposely, but if you do not do it purposely, it is not your action. That means, in order to be an action, in order to be a behavior, in order to call a behavior an action, it has to be backed by freedom. And in order that you have acted freely, it will imply that there are plurality of choices. If there is no choice, freedom is meaningless. If there is no freedom, action doesn't take place. If there is no action or freedom, action with freedom, then neither good nor bad. I'll give an example. This is how an action is different from an event. For example, the palpitation of the heart is not an action. It is taking place in me, heart is palpitating. It is an event. It is an event caused by certain physiological states. My blinking of the eye is an event because I don't do it. Whether I want it or not, it does happen. So event is that takes place. But action is that which you do. Suppose, because of some nervous neural weakness, my hand is like trembling like this. Is it an action or event? It is an event. So, what is the hand? 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 So, the hand is the hand. What is the hand? What is the hand? It is an event because they are caused by certain conditions. The trembling of the hand when the hand of a old man trembles, it is due to nervous weakness. It is caused by neural weakness. But when you tremble, your hand trembles, your body trembles because of cold, it is caused by external conditions. Be it external or internal conditions, the trembling of the heart, your hand, is caused. So it is an event. Suppose in a drama, you are playing the role of an old man in winter. Suppose you are playing the role of an old man in winter, you do like this. Babare. It is not an event. It is something which you are making it happen. It's an action. So action is what we do, whereas event is that which takes place. Palpitation of the heart, blinking of the eyes, circulation of the blood, thunder, lightning, disease, super cyclone, tsunami, these are all events. Because events are understood or intelligible in terms of the antecedents. Given the antecedents, the effect will definitely sure to come. Predictability is there. But in case of actions, there is no predictability. Because action is something which you do. So, we come to another point of distinction. That means, action is different from an event. What animals do are events, are part of the events. They are hungry, they take. Thirsty, they get angry, they pounce. Without thinking of the consequence. This is an event. So event is something that, but what is action? Action is something which you perform with freedom. So to do an action is a human prerogative. It is only human beings who can be said to act. And when you act, what happens? What happens when you act? Every action has its consequence. Every action, isn't it? Whatever you do, it has its consequence. Suppose somebody is hungry, a leper comes to your house, a beggar comes to you. You give the beggar a food, he is hungry. So it has some consequence, visible consequence. Suppose you scare him away with hot water, garam paani pakailo. Se gota karma tarana karma phala achi. Bhala padila, result bhala hala. Cinema dekhila, saman nashta kala, tar gota manisha jaha kare tar karma phala thae. Karma jemti hava, phala semti hava. As is the action, so is the consequence. Okay? Suppose gota janakar bahut papara bahut paisa achi, se paisa gota lagaye. Kon karibo? ସେ ବହୁତ ଖରାପ କାମରେ ମଦ ଖାଇକିରି ବା ସିନେମା ଦେଖିକିରି ସାଙ୍ଗମାନଙ୍କୁ ପଠାଇ ଦେଇପାରେ କିମ୍ବା ସେଇ ପଇସାକୁ ଲଗେଇକିରି ୟୁଜ୍ ଇଟ୍ ଆଜ୍ ଏ କ୍ୟାପିଟାଲ ଆଣ୍ଡ ହି ୟୁ ନୋ ତାର ଆକ୍ୟୁମୁଲେଟ୍ସ ୱେଲ୍ଥ ଆଣ୍ଡ ଇନକ୍ରିଜେସ୍ ଇଜ୍ ଇଏ ବିକମ୍ସ ମୋର ଆଣ୍ଡ ମୋର ସଲ୍ଭେଣ୍ଟ ଆଉ ଜଣେ କହିବ ନା ମୁଁ କିଛି ରଖିବିନି ମୁଁ ସବୁ ଦେଇକି ସନ୍ଧ୍ୟା ହେଇ ପଳେ ଚଏସେସ୍ ଆର୍ ଓପନ୍ ସୋ ଏ ମ୍ୟାନ୍ ହାଜ୍ ଏ ଫ୍ରିଡମ୍ ଟୁ ମେକ୍ ୟୁ ନୋ ୟୁଟିଲାଇଜ୍ ଦ ମନି ହ୍ୱିଚ୍ ହି ହାଜ୍ ଗଟ୍ ହ୍ୱିଚ୍ ହାଜ୍ ବିନ୍ ଗିଭନ୍ ଟୁ ହିମ୍ ବାଇ ହିଜ୍ ଫାଦର or which has inherited from the wealth he has inherited from others, in any of these different ways. But as is the way, so is the consequence. As is the way, so is the consequence. That means, bujhiyochana nahi. To manushara gote swadhinata mane freedom achi, eta karbi na seta karbi na seta karbi na seta karbi. And there lies your agency purusharth. That means your uniqueness consists in choosing this rather than the rest of the alternatives. So freedom always presupposes the presence of alternatives. And when you act with the freedom, jodi freedom na thibo seta action kuha jibo na mu hatta bujha le tama gale jore chatpet marla mu marla se marla par mu ichha kare marla na to whenever there is an action it is something which you do. Event is that takes place, action is something that you do with freedom, with choice. Therefore, you are responsible for the consequence maps. Let me take an example. Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita begins with a sense of reluctance, hesitation, confusion on the part of Arjuna, isn't it? War filter, originally. Entire Bhagavad Gita is a discourse, is a conversation between Lord Krishna is Arjuna. Simple. All the 18 chapters are only discourses between the two. What is the sum and substance called? When you open the Bhagavad Gita, we find that Arjuna is utterly confused. There is freedom. There is freedom. What do you do? Typical Hamlesian dilemma. To be or not to be. What do you do? ସେମାନଙ୍କର ସବୁ ତାଙ୍କର ନଷ୍ଟ ହେବ ସବୁ ମାନେ ବର୍ଣ୍ଣଶଙ୍କର ଜାତ ହେବେ ବାଷ୍ଟର୍ଡ ସୁଲ ବର୍ନ ଇଟ୍ ୱିଲ୍ ପଲ୍ୟୁଟ୍ ଦ ରେସ୍ ବଟ୍ ଇଫ୍ ଆଇ ୱିନ୍ ହ୍ୱାଟ୍ ୱିଲ୍ ହ୍ୟାପନ୍ ଇଫ୍ ଆଇ ୱିନ୍ ଦ୍ୟାଟ୍ ଦେ ୱିଲ୍ ଡାଏ ବିକଜ୍ ଅର୍ଜୁନ କ୍ୟାନଟ୍ ୱିନ୍ ଅନ୍ଲେସ୍ କୌରବସ୍ ଡାଏ ଇଫ୍ ଦେ ୱିନ୍ ଦି କନ୍ସିକ୍ୱେନ୍ସ ଇଜ୍ ଅନ୍ପାଲେଟେବଲ୍ ଇଫ୍ ଆଇ ଡୁ ନଟ୍ ୱିନ୍ ଏଗେନ୍ ଦେର୍ ଇଜ୍ ଅ ଡେଥ୍ ଅଫ୍ ରାଇଚିୟସ୍ନେସ୍ ଆମେ ସତ୍ପଥ ରହିଛୁ ସତ୍ର ଇଏ ହେଇଯିବ ସତ୍ର ହାରିଯିବ ଧର୍ମଟା କରାଯାଏ ହବ ସୋ ବୋଥ୍ ଦି ଅଲ୍ଟରନେଟିଭ୍ସ ଆର୍ ନଟ୍ ଆକ୍ସେପ୍ଟେବଲ୍ ସୋ ଅର୍ଜୁନ ଇଜ୍ ଅନ୍ ଆକ୍ଟିଂ ଇଜ୍ ଏ ଏଜେଣ୍ଟ ଇଜ୍ ଟୁ ଆକ୍ଟ ଆଣ୍ଡ ଦେର୍ ଆର୍ ଟୁ ଏକ୍ସକ୍ଲୁସିଭ୍ ଚଏସେସ୍ ଯେମିତି ମଣିଷର ବର୍ତ୍ତମାନ ଦୁଇଟା ଚଏସ୍ ଆଇଦର୍ ଟୁ ଲିଭ୍ ଟୁଗେଦର୍ ଅର୍ ଟୁ ଡାଏ ନା ନାହିଁ ସାଇଣ୍ଟିଷ୍ଟ ମାନେ କହୁଛନ୍ତି ଲେଟ୍ ଅସ୍ ଷ୍ଟପ୍ ସାଇନ୍ସ ବୈଜ୍ଞାନିକ ମାନେ କହୁଛନ୍ତି ବର୍ତ୍ତମାନ ଆଉ ବୈଜ୍ଞାନିକ କିଛି ଉଦ୍ଭାବନ କରିବା ନାହିଁ କାହିଁକି ନା ଏତେ ଉଦ୍ଭାବନ ହେଇଗଲାଣି ଯେ ଏଇଟା ମଣିଷ ପାଇଁ କ୍ଷତିକାରକ ହବ କାହିଁକି ସେ ଜାଣିନି ତା ସହ ଚଳିବ କେମିତି ଗୋଟେ ନ୍ୟୁଟ୍ରନ୍ ବମ୍ ତିଆରି କରୁଛ ନ୍ୟୁକ୍ଲିୟର୍ ପାୱାର ତିଆରି କରୁଛ ନ୍ୟୁକ୍ଲିୟର୍ ପାୱାର ନ୍ୟୁଟ୍ରନ୍ ମଧ୍ୟ ଲୋକ ମାରିଯାଇପାରିବେ ସେଥିରେ ଆମ ଇଲେକ୍ଟ୍ରିସିଟି ପ୍ରତି ଗାଁ ଗାଁ ଯାଇପାରିବ କିନ୍ତୁ ମଣିଷ କ'ଣ ବୁଝିନି ମ୍ୟାନ୍ ଇଜ୍ ନଟ୍ ୱାଇଜ୍ ଏନଫ୍ ଟୁ ୟୁଟିଲାଇଜ୍ ଇଟ୍ ଗୋଟେ ଛୁରୀଟେ ପିଲାଙ୍କୁ ଦେଇଦେଲେ ସେ କ'ଣ କରିବ ସେ ନିଜର ମାରିଦେଇପାରେ ଗୋଟେ ଗୋଟେ ଲଣ୍ଠନଟେ ଡିବିଟେ ତାକୁ ଦେଇଦେଲେ